Well, I think it's a different way of looking at the world and world politics. I'm very skeptical of the notion that we can build a truly universal framework. We live in an age of differences, of radical differences, and perhaps they can be reconciled at a very high philosophical level, or they can be reconciled in history, 50, 100 years from now. But they cannot be reconciled immediately in practical politics. The differences between the Chinese model and the European model are deep, radical, historical, philosophical, and profound. So when I speak about Eurasia, I certainly don't speak in terms of a unified supercontinent living together in peace and happiness and following the same ideas and the same feelings, which I think is different from the idea of Eurasia that many people have. I think about it as a space, but a space of difference and competition. It always attracts me the idea that you can live and explore contradictory ways of life without being obsessed about reconciling them, about homogenizing them, about bringing them together, and in fact at the end concluding that they are really the same. I'm not attracted by that idea that all our differences are superficial. I'm much more attracted by the idea that different human beings pursue different visions of the world, and they are in some respects contradictory, and that's fine. That's, by the way, the vision inspiring modern science. If you're always concerned about reducing everything to an equal measure, you end up with very shallow way of thinking, a very shallow way of living. So Eurasian for me is about accepting these deep differences, but being interested in them and being interested in looking at the world from different perspectives. It's a very ambitious, very bold project, which depending whom you talk to in Beijing, could be a project to be concluding in 2049 or a project to be concluded 100 years from now. So a long-term project. We're only in the initial stages. There's already a number of shifts and oscillations and rethinking going on, and we'll see more of that and probably more radical than that. But the commitment in Beijing continues to be very strong. So I don't see the Belt and Road being dropped by the Beijing authorities. I see a story that will continue to be the story for the rest of our lives. You know, I decided to become interested in this, which means that I'll have to be interested in it for the next 30 years, and maybe my children and grandchildren will be following the next few chapters of the Belt and Road, because it really is a project for the next few decades. So it's a project to expand all throughout this century.